Let's see. Hello, everyone. It's Kara with Sift by Kara here in my home, ready to get started with a bottle cake tutorial. I am just checking everything. If you are tuning in and you get, let me show you something because this has been happening. If you get this, an error has occurred. Go ahead and refresh your page. There we are, see me? And then here's a button that says be part of the conversation. You can click on that and you will be able to see me.
I am just checking everything.
Let me turn myself down. And then you can ask a question here and we'll get started that way. I'm gonna move this out the way and go back to me so I don't confuse myself. Okay, so joining me today, I have Jennifer England. She's my best friend, cake friend. I just love her. And she's gonna be with me today to help answer or ask me the questions and so I can answer you while I'm working. And then, you know, too, to just sort of give me her take on things too. She's really good as well. You should check her out, La Bella Torta. Say hi, Jen.
Hi.
Thanks so much for being with me today.
Anytime.
Okay, guys. I'm not sure if anybody is here right now. So, it's the thing about going live. But I see two viewers. That might be me. I don't know if Jen is on there too. It might just be us, Jennifer. Hope not. I know I've got several people purchased the class, so hopefully you guys are all here. I will just talk a little bit before we get started. I am Kara Bustos. My business is called Sift by Kara. You can find me on Facebook, Instagram, Sift, SiftByKara, Sift by Kara. I also have a YouTube channel that's slowly growing. I have a lot of paid tutorials and some free tutorials that you can check out. And I'm doing better about posting regularly, so we'll see how that goes. I am in my home. This is my home kitchen. It is a Sunday, and I thought I'd do a Sunday tutorial for those who can't make it during the week. But because it's Sunday, my whole family is here. And I have three girls, and my husband, he's watching football right now, and my other girls are upstairs. So just in case, oh, Ashley says she's here. Hi, Ashley. Ashley is here. Thanks for joining us, Ashley. So excited to have you here. So if by chance some crazy child comes running through here, we'll shoo them off quickly. But just to let you know. Okay, well, let's get started because we got a lot to do today, and I'm hoping actually to be done within 2 hours, if not less. So we're going to jam ahead. So I have already done quite a bit of work on the bottle cake, only because the process to actually make a bottle cake takes a bit of time, and I don't know about you, but I don't know that I could sit through a tutorial for several hours while I watch someone painstakingly go through the process. So I went ahead and videotaped the beginning process. Before I get started, we are going to be turning this bottle into cake form. And this is how I get started. So somebody says, I want a bottle cake, and you say, great, I can do that for you. And you want it to be standing up versus laying down as a cake, and, you know, half of the bottle is flat. And those are nice, too, but I think a pretty awesome cake is to have it stand up. So, and I'm already hearing kids screaming. Okay, so there's a couple ways to do that. what I've done here is I went ahead and measured this particular bottle. So if you're doing a particular bottle and you can actually get an actual bottle, so if this is a Coors beer bottle cake, and you get a Coors beer bottle, an actual, this is real liquor, people. I won't drink it, but this is real liquor. It's a real bottle. And what I've done is I went ahead and I measured sort of to get an idea of the size of this. So this is roughly about 2.5 inches. So for a small cake to feed probably 25 people, I'm just going to basically double this. So 2.5 circumference is this, though. So if it's 2.5 circle, then I'm going to go with a 5-inch cake. So, and then we're going to measure the height, and that's about 9 inches. So I'm going to make the cake 18 inches tall. So we're going 5 by 18 inches tall. So that's how we decide cake. Now, if you want this cake to be, to feed more people, you just have to get your math, and I'm not very good at math, but I have to, you have to give me some time with that. But I have done champagne bottle cakes, and do I have, I don't have one handy right now. Oh, I do, 1 second. I do have a champagne bottle. So if you're going to do a champagne bottle cake, this one is perfect. This is like 3 inches. So I would just double this to a 6-inch round, and this is going to be a taller cake. That's about 12 inches, 12 and a half, so about 24 inches tall. So, and that would feed probably, I don't know, 35, 40, probably more, depending on how big the slices are. But a good size cake. If you are going to have a larger cake than, say, the 25 serving cake, perhaps the 6-inch serving cake for a champagne bottle, I would suggest that you use a support system of wood. Now, this I got at Michael's. They're in the little craft wood section. They're already pre-cut. You would need a larger one than this. So I believe there are cake sites that actually have masonite boards that you can cut, that have cut to your size, so 10-inch, 12-inch, 14-inch, and they're wood surfaces, which you would then take this lovely device, which is a plumbing floor flange. I believe I'm saying that right. I don't know if you can see Jennifer at all. She might not want. Don't pick your nose, Jennifer. You might be seen. Here, let me see if you're being seen. Oh, no, you're not being seen. Okay. Jennifer, just nod at me if I'm saying anything wrong, because I, you know, you're the hardwood person. She does, Jennifer does all this stuff. She makes all kind of furniture, and, I mean, goodness, the woman can do anything. So, anywho, you get a floor flange, right? Floor flange.
That is a floor flange.
Okay. And you would find center. Again, this would have to be a larger size board, a cake circle, hardwood, to fit your cake. Just find center and drill, screw in 4 screws there, and it gets locked in place. And I'm not as prepared as I thought. 1 more second. Okay, I have so you have your hardwood drilled in, screwed in, and it's firm in your hardwood base. So then what you would need is one of these. It's a...
It's an adapter.
Thank you. It's an adapter. Good Lord. And it screws in. Here, let me tilt this down. It'll screw in here. So after you have this all nice and tight, okay, make sure you get the right size. This is an adapter for a half-inch PVC pipe, and here's the PVC pipe. It's just a small one for now that's already been cut. So you would cut this to the size that you need, and you would just push it in there. And that is your support system for your bottle cake. Okay, now this system is good for larger cakes, heavier cakes. You definitely want something much more sturdy than what I use today. And I'm going to show you the other option for a smaller cake, less expensive option, very easy. You most likely have already have all of the things ready to go. This support system, you need a run to Lowe's or Home Depot or something. So, hope I explained that pretty well.
I think so.
Yeah? Did I do that? Did I do good, Jennifer? Okay. Okay, so I'm going to set this aside because I did not use this system, but I am going to show you what system I did use. So, go over here, and I have put a video together for you. All right, so this is what I used. I took a regular cake drum, cardboard, and I found center using my ruler. And we'll wait for it to... Okay, then with my X-Acto knife, I carefully made a hole or carved out a hole into the center all the way through to the bottom. And you can see this is the size dowel, wooden dowel that I use. And I want that dowel to fit very snugly. So you can see the hole is not very big at all. So definitely make sure you don't make your hole too big. I went ahead and stuck the dowel inside and I measured. And you can see there's a little mark line where I measured where I want to cut that. I don't want it to peek out of the top of my cake. Went ahead and used my serrated knife and cut it at the mark. I use that knife for pretty much everything. Those serrated knives are really good. Get you one if you don't have one. Long and medium. So here I used my Super 77 spray and I took a smaller regular cake circle, cardboard circle, and I glued it to the bottom. This is the bottom of the cake drum. You can see the hole is already through, and I went ahead and glued a smaller cake circle to the bottom of my cake drum. Let me know if any of this is not making sense, Jen. Stop me and I will.
Makes sense to me.
Okay, so I flipped it back over, and with my hot glue gun, I just loaded that little hole with lots and lots and lots of very hot glue. And I was ready to go with my dowel, and I stuck the dowel inside the hole. And I went ahead and put more glue around the bottom of the dowel meeting the board. So that is what you're seeing here. And let it dry. I found a really small cake circle, just enough to get over, to go around my dowel. And I'm going to use this cake's circle cutter to mark my 5-inch round cake circles. I'm going to need 3 of those for this cake. This is pretty much a 3-tiered cake going into this bottle cake we're going to show you today. So here I'm just marking center using my circle cutter with my pencil, and I just marked a line around it. Again, I don't want the hole too big. using my X-Acto knife, which needs a new blade, I went ahead and cut the hole out of my one of my 5-inch round cake circles. And I went ahead and used that same cut circle to then mark my other 2 cake circles, as you can see here. And I went ahead and cut those out. So that's what we need. So here I am showing you how I made modeling chocolate. I'm going to pause the video real quick. We're going to use modeling chocolate for the neck. Let me come off screen share. All of this right here is cake. This is a very safe, sturdy cake right here. This part right here, not so much. So this is where you can do one of two things, or maybe three. I choose to either use modeling chocolate for the neck or Rice Krispie treats. So I have used Rice Krispie treats before. You can certainly do that. For this tutorial, I used modeling chocolate. So here is how to make modeling chocolate. And I actually really like Jessica Harris' recipe for modeling chocolate, and I believe it's 14 ounces of chocolate to 3 ounces of corn syrup measured. So let's go back to the video.
Is that chocolate or candy melts?
Candy melts. Thank you, Jennifer. Candy melts. Yes, candy melts. So this is candy melts here. Start the video. And this is just the melted chocolate that I melted into 14 ounces of melted chocolate from the I already mixed it. We already showed that part. I already mixed in the corn syrup. And so I'm just folding it over, trying not to over mix it. And you can see it's turning into a bit of a Play-Doh consistency. Again, just trying to incorporate all the corn syrup.
Is the corn syrup warm when you add it to the melted candy?
I did warm it up a little bit for like, I think 10 seconds or so before I added into my melted chocolate. And here I'm just going to use some saran wrap and press it down, flatten it down to about a half of an inch, and then covering it. I'm going to let this sit out for about an hour. I think that's why I like Jessica's recipe and method, because you don't have to let it sit overnight. So it's been about an hour unwrapping it here, and I'm just going to knead it until it becomes nice, a nice consistency of modeling chocolate. And I'm going to just wrap it up again until I knead it. Excuse me. Okay, so we'll stop here. Excuse me, I have a little cough. I don't use an ag bay. I hear they're great. I saw Manette Rushing use one, and she made that look like a must-buy. So if you have an ag bay, good for you. I'm sure you love it. I don't have one. I'm very limited in my space, so I like to use a long serrated knife to cut my layers. So before I move on with the video, I'm just going to explain what you're seeing here. These are 5-inch round cakes. I made them in my 5-inch round cake pans, 2-inch high. I filled them all the way to the top, and then I just trimmed off the dome on most of them except for one. And so what I'm doing here is I'm positioning my long serrated knife in the middle of one of my cakes so that I can tort it into two hopefully very even layers. And I'm going to use, I'll start the video now, I'm going to use my turntable to help guide me. These cakes were frozen, so you'll see me flip my cake over because I really did not want to get sliced by that. That long serrated knife trying to get through some of the frozen part of the cake. So I don't typically do that, but just to let you know why. So here I'm just scoring a line and using my turntable, and that's where I'm flipping it because I was not going to get cut today. And there I have two pieces. So that circle that we used, and I already cut my hole. You can see I used the dowel to sort of mark, and I used that little cutter to help cut out little holes of cake. That dowel comes in handy. And then, again, using one of my cake circles, I'm just marking my layers. So I'm going to do this to all, let's see how many I did. I did one, two, I think I did three or four. Oh, here's the dome one. I left the dome on because that's going to be the top of my bottle cake. And since it's already sort of domed and rounded, I like to just sort of use that to help me, to help start me off. Again, using my cake circle, I'm marking, and my cake circle cutter, and making sure that all of my holes line up. Again, you see I'm not making the hole very big, you guys. I don't want a lot of space. I want the cake and the cake circles to be really tight. Let me pause the video here. To be really tight around the middle dowel. Okay, so here I'm showing you how I'm stacking my cakes. So getting one of the cake boards, I'm going to stack four layers high. I'm using a smaller spatula, offset spatula, to make sure that the hole in the cake and the hole in the cake board are all lined up. I'm putting, and there you see I am finding my hole again. Lining everything up, pushing out any air bubbles that may come into play. You don't need to put a lot of filling because we're going four layers high here. So nice, it'll be a nice cupcake. So I'm just got my ruler. I just want to make sure. Let me pause right here and explain something. Go back. So. Oh, that's not working. So when I got my ruler out, I'm going to pause right there and come back. When I got my ruler out, what I'm trying to do is make sure that the cakes that I'm stacking are not going to, when put together, are not going to go past this mark. So if right before the bin starts, it's about 4 inches on the bottle, that means the two cakes below can't go past 8 inches, because remember we're doubling in size. So I'm making sure that one of my cakes doesn't go really any further than 4 inches high, or 5 inches. Because then I'm just keep measuring. Actually, it's probably more like 5 inches, so double will be 10, so 9 inches. So you'll see what I mean. So that's why I broke out the ruler during my stacking process. So let's go back to the video. So I'm just making sure I can really do four layers here. So we'll just continue to stack the next layer onto the cake. I'm not seeing any questions, so if you have a question, please make sure you enter it. And if you're coming in late and we end the session before you can get a question, just ask me a question under the YouTube video and I'll be happy to answer you. Okay, so again, I was just finding my hole, making sure there's a clean hole all the way through. And now I'm just going to do a crumb coat.
And that is meringue that you're using?
You know what? I'm actually, it's funny because this is a demo cake, guys, so I'm actually using whatever I had in my freezer, and I think it's a combination of Swiss meringue and American buttercream and some other buttercream that I had with coconut and pecans or something. So it's a bit of everything, but it's working just fine. It's going to be delicious.
I just said now I'm hungry.
Yeah, it's going to be great. So I'm just doing a quick crumb coat. Okay, so let me pause the video here. So now what you're seeing me do is, let me go back a little bit. So now what you're seeing me do is I've already done two identical cake layers. This one, sorry, I keep doing that and it shows up. The second one you see here is also stacked on one of the pre-cut cake boards with the hole in the middle as well. So now you see my system already in place on my turntable, and I'm just going to thread the cake onto.
And those are chilled down?
They're very chilled, yes. Not frozen, but very chilled. So here I'm doweling my bottom cake. I'm putting five. These are not the big, what do they call them? Bubble tea straws. They're just thicker, thicker drinking straws, more like shake straws or something. So this is how I support my cakes. Very quick and easy. I'm going to put a little bit of buttercream on top to kind of marry the second cake onto it. And not too much. I'm scraping it down a bit because I want it to be flat as possible, as level as possible. And I'm just threading the next one through. And you see how tight it is as it's going down. You want that dowel and the cake board and the cake all to be really snug. You don't want to have big holes. You don't want that cake to move too much around the dowel. So here I'm measuring again, going back to making sure that this doesn't go any taller than, say, I think it was 9 inches that I wanted it. So I have too much. So I'm just cutting off that little bit of cake there. And now I am going to put more dowels because we have a third cake that's going to sit on top of that. So make sure your cakes are supported. You don't want your bottle cake to shrink on you. you don't want it to collapse on itself, so make sure it's supported. These are the pieces of cut straw that I did on the last cake. So it was perfect. I didn't waste. Again, more buttercream to seal in that top part of that cake, getting it as flat as I can. Now what I'm doing is I'm going ahead and putting my ganache on. I'm going to pause the video. If any of you have taken my ganache tutorials with the acrylics, I probably, but for the sake of this video, I did it. But I probably would have used my ganache technique with acrylics on the individual cakes before I stacked them, and it would have given me a really perfect cylinder. But for the purposes of this class, I did not do that. And so I am winging it, as most of you who probably don't have acrylics do all the time. So here I am just ganaching the entire double barrel cake at this point without my acrylics. However, did I make myself clear? You can individually, both the individual cakes, you can pre-ganache them using my acrylic technique and then stack them. And then you can marry them together with a little bit of ganache between the two, and then to seal the seam between the two cakes. But for this purposes, I did not do that. So moving on. So now what I'm doing is I'm just ganaching the two bottom cakes. You can also stack the third cake on top and do your carving before you ganache. That is also, that works just as fine as well. I don't know why I do certain things the way I do it. I just do. Either way works just fine. So just getting a lot of ganache on there. Oh, and there's my favorite bench scraper. It's a Fat Girl Cakes bench scraper. That's the tall one. I think that's the 10-inch one. I think she has a 12-inch size as well. I don't have that one. The 10-inch works just fine for me. So I'm not going to worry about putting ganache on the very top portion of the cake because we still need to put the third cake on top. So I'm just finishing this up, and as I finish this, I'm going to set this into the refrigerator and let it firm up nicely for me. And it doesn't have to be completely perfect right here because we still have quite a bit of work left to do. So I'm not too concerned. I just want to get a decent covering on it. So the cake has been firmed up. And now I'm going to add the third cake on top. This cake is frozen. This is straight out of the freezer. And the reason why is because we're going to be doing some carving here. So this is actually only 3 layers tall. Again, getting my, I'm always measuring, trying to figure out where I'm going to start my bend. You can see the bottle next to me. I have it next to me as my reference. You can see how frozen this cake is. It makes it so much easier to carve frozen cake. Don't be scared to get in there and start carving. A lot of people get scared at the carving part of cake, and don't cut your hand. I think I nicked myself. Don't cut your hand there. Just get in there and go for it. Taking a little bit off at a time is best. It's much easier to take away than it is to put back. So just start small and keep trimming a little bit at a time. Again, always measuring, always referencing my my bottle. And just keep going. So this is actually, guys, this is probably the top part of the cake is the longest, probably the longest part of this cake. So you can see how much cake I'm wasting, by the way. So when you're thinking about how much to charge for this cake, you're going to spend, to do the cake right, you're going to spend a good amount of time carving, and you're going to spend a good amount of material that gets wasted. And you have, the customer needs to pay for that. Okay? So make sure you're charging correctly. I do a lot of measuring, so to speak, with my hand. You'll see me glide my hands up along the cake, trying to see if I can visually feel the bottle. So I do a lot of that. I don't know that I have any real method to tell you other than you just have to get in there. You see me? using my hands to kind of get a feel. So you see, I'm taking a little bit away at a time. And at this point, I am trying to get that deep neck curve. So I scored a line so that I know to stop myself from going down any further. And I'm just really carving in that deeper neck area. Again, make sure your cake is frozen when you do this, because if it was not frozen, you'd have a very terrible time, especially with chocolate cake. I want to say that I probably took a good hour carving this part of the cake. Maybe not quite an hour, but yeah. This whole process actually probably is going to take me about two and a half hours, I think, to get the shape of the bottle. Now I'm going to ganache. That's what I was saying again earlier. If you wanted to stack the whole cake and carve it before you do the ganache, you can certainly do that as well. I'm not quite sure why I chose to do it the other way. I think because I wanted to make sure that the bottom two cake layers didn't get crumbly or get in the way when I went to carve. The ganache keeps it like a hard shell around it. I did I'll have to show you another tool that I used to smooth. You can fast forward. No, I think we're almost there. Hope I'm not boring you too much.
Not me.
I just want to show that it's a process, you guys. This does not happen quickly. It is a process. Oh, that tool that I'm using is actually a cutting mat, and I just cut out a square, and it's perfect because I can curve it around. What I'm doing here is, if when you see a bottle, when it sits down, it kind of curves in. So I'm just taking away some of the ganache and kind of creating a curve to the bottom of the cake. A very slight curve. I don't want it to be straight down because that doesn't look that realistic. So I'm creating a little bit of a curve at the bottom of my cake. And cleaning that up. Now what I'm doing is I'm going to add my modeling chocolate. So I'm just wrapping a large piece of modeling chocolate around the center dowel. This is a very crude process. I don't really have a good method other than just get in there and start forming. I probably spent another good hour forming the neck of this cake. So using my knife and trying to get it to sort of taking the extra pieces and filling in the other areas, trying to get a nice sort of curve into the cake. Doing my best to smooth it out. Now, I don't like it right here. It wasn't looking like the bottle for me, so I went ahead and started carving out a little bit more of that neck. I needed it to look a little more dramatic with the curve. So that's all I'm doing here is shaving down the cake a little bit more, and then I'm going to go back and fill it back in with ganache. So you can see it takes a bit of time. This is why you got to charge the big money. So here I am adding ganache to the neck part of the cake, and I'm actually using ganache too to help bulk up my neck as well, to give it the neck of the bottle is a little thicker than maybe I had started off with, so I'm using quite a bit of ganache to do that. I use my hands a lot. I clean my hands very well, make sure my fingernails are clean, but I like to get my hands on the cake, especially the chocolate part, because the warmth of my hands just really helps melt down the chocolate a little bit to smooth it, make it more smooth. So don't be scared. I don't know if using gloves would be helpful, because the heat, you've got to get the heat of your fingers to help mold the chocolate. So like I said, I spent a good, at least an hour. I know my video went 45 minutes, but I spent a good hour. So what I'm doing is I'm adding a little bit of modeling chocolate to the very tip. There's a ridge right at the tip of the bottle, and I want it to incorporate that ridge. So I'm now just smoothing all of that down and covering it with more ganache. You can do this whole process with buttercream. I will say ganache is better because it just keeps that cake, it just keeps everything in place, and you don't have to worry so much about the buttercream getting warm on you as you're working. So, hey, it's me again. So that's where we are, guys. That's how I got my bottle cake to take shape here. So now what I'm going to do, and I don't see any questions, so we're going to move on because we really want to get this done over the next hour. So I'm just going to reset myself. And I'm going to switch cameras. Okay. So here's my cake. It's already ready to go. Now, because I did not use my acrylic method, my cylinder on the cake is not perfect. So I do highly suggest you use my ganache buttercream tutorial with the acrylics on the bottom portion of your cake. You'll get a really nice cylinder. Not perfect here, but I did mark where I thought it was most perfect from the front. So I just put a little X right there, because that's where I thought it looked the most appealing. So what we're going to do now is we're going to prep our fondant, because the hardest part is getting fondant on this cake. So I have my white fondant here. I'm going with white fondant because I'm going to airbrush this cake. So I use LMF fondant, Liz Merrick. You can Google Liz Merrick or LMF fondant and you will find her artisan cake company, and she shows you how to make her fondant or whatever fondant of your liking. Take my watch off. So how do we measure the fondant to go around the bottle cake. What we want to do is we want to first see how tall it is. It is a little over 18, so about 19 inches tall. So I definitely want to go at least 20 inches tall in length. And then we're going to measure around the cake. And it's coming at about 18 inches around. So I need to roll out a strip of fondant that is 20, 21 by 19 wide. Make sure I don't have chocolate on my hands. So I have my fondant. I'm going to roll it out. I have my long ruler here. And I want to roll it out to about how tall the piece of fondant needs to be. So that's about 20 inches. I have my cornstarch. I use cornstarch. I don't want it sticking. After you do all that rolling and then you go to pick it up and it sticks, yeah, that's no fun. You don't want to do that. So I'm very generous with my cornstarch. Maybe too generous, but I don't need my fondant to stretch too much because I'm a panel girl. If you've watched my other videos, you'll know I do a lot of paneling. So I don't need my fondant to be stretchy. I actually need it to be a little bit stiffer. So I am going to roll this out. And remember, I want to roll it out so that it's 19. I'm going to move this. I don't want it to fall. We'll stick that right there. Make sure, guys, if you have any questions, to go ahead and type in a question and let me know. The fun part about doing live is that you can talk to me, ask me a question on the spot, and I can answer it. So get your questions in. Okay, so we're thick. We're not quite there yet. I like to roll my fondant out to about an eighth, if I can, an eighth of an inch thick. And it's a little still on the thick side, but I want to make sure I'm not sticking. Okay, let me take a look and see how I'm measuring. So not quite there yet. I am rolling on my kitchen table. Not the best surface, but when you're baking from home, you work with what you have. Hopefully I'm not sticking under there. So let me see where my measuring is now. Remember, we need to be at least 20. We are way over. We're definitely good there. And we are good here. So, I'm going to make a cut one end, measuring down I'm going to widen it out a little bit more on this thing. All right, good. So I'm going to cut. Now, I don't need this long. This is way too long. So I'm going to make one clean cut. And this is feeling a little thick down here. So I am going to thin that out a little bit. Make another cut here. Okay, so now I need to go at least 20, 21 inches tall. That is about there. And I'm going to leave this there because I'm going to need that in a minute. Okay, so here is my panel. Please don't be sticking on me. So I'm going to put this on a cookie sheet. It's not going to fit great, but you could roll this up on a rolling pin if you'd like. Try not to make any holes on this.
Would a cake board work, like a pan size cake board?
Yeah, I mean, it's going to hang off a little bit. That's okay, though, as long as it doesn't tear on me. Okay, I think I'm going to stick this in my freezer. So I'm going to be right back. I folded up the edges. I'm going to unfold it once I get in my freezer. Right back.
I don't know about the rest of you, but I'm mesmerized. I'm really enjoying this. So I figured I would fill the dead air here with just me saying that. I love watching Kara work.
Okay. So I went ahead and put that in my freezer. And the reason why I put it in the freezer is because it's going to stiffen up that fondant for me so that I can lift it up with my hands without it folding and stretching and just being a complete mess. So the freezer technique is really great for that. And I only want it to be in the freezer for really only about 5 minutes. So I'm going to put my fondant that I'm not using. So one of the things that I want to do is I want to, you know, the more detail from the actual bottle you can put onto your cake, the better. I don't know. Let me see. You can see this. There is a little ridge right here on the bottom and at the top and some detailing here. I want to capture this effect. And the way to do that is we're going to build up the cake with fondant prior to wrapping our cake. So, I already have this leftover piece here. Remember, we're doubling in size, so measuring that piece, that's like an inch. So I need 2 inches. I don't know if this is 2 inches. No. Not quite. I'll just use. I'm going to do one edge, do a straight edge here. Let me know, Jen, if anything is blocking the view.
Nope, I can see perfectly.
Okay, so I'm going to give myself a 2-inch mark. And I'm hoping this is the right length. It is. Okay. So I'm going to mark this at 2 inches. I want a 2-inch strip. And the thickness of this fondant is actually pretty good. And then there's this little one. And I think I'm just going to measure that with this already pre, what do we call this? A ribbon cutter. That's going to be our top one. Okay. I'm going to hold on to these strips because I need them. I'm going to take my cake, find my front. There's my front. We like that front. Let me get some water. Okay, so I'm taking a little bit of water, and I'm just going to brush the bottom where I want my fondant to stick. Okay, so I'm going to carefully take my strip. And wrap it around the bottom. Need to look at it, make sure. Okay, so here in the back, can we see that?
Yes.
Oh, wait, let me pull it back. There we go. Where the two flaps meet. Hopefully I can get all this lined up. I'm going to cut through both. And marry my seams here. Now remember, in the video I showed you where I kind of cut into the bottom to kind of create a little bit of a curve under. So I want to make sure that I maintain that curve there. Okay, so the next strip is going around, let me look in my bottle. It starts right about here, or maybe here, because that other detail goes up here. So right where this curve starts, I will finding my front again. I'm doing my best. Did not stretch my fondant one and keep it nice and lined up. I like it. So going back again, going through both And I'm going to try, I would turn this, but then I would lose everything. I'm going to try to, the seam that I made on the bottom, I'm going to try to line up the seam at the top. And I'm cutting through both, peeling back, getting rid of the extra, and marrying my seams. So I want to just take this time to look at it, make sure it's nice and level appearance-wise. Nothing's perfect, guys. Nothing's perfect, but we want the overall cake to look perfect. Okay, so that's that. Now, has it been 5 minutes, Jen?
It has been about 5 minutes, yes.
Okay, good. That's about as long as I want to keep my fondant in the freezer. Any longer, it's going to get too sticky on me, and I don't want that. I'm just adjusting this band a little bit. Okay, so now I'm going to brush the whole cake. Uh-oh, too much water. The whole cake with water.
Could this be done with the spritz bottle as well?
You know, I guess it could. I just don't use that. So sure, why not? My only concern about the spritz bottle is that it may miss a spot. You don't want to miss a spot, but I guess you could miss a spot with a brush too. So just be careful that you make sure the entire surface of your cake gets covered. Just doing that all the way around. Again, if this were buttercream, you would want to leave your cake. Don't you just love these hairs from the brushes? You want to leave your cake in the refrigerator as long as possible until you're ready to cover it. So this is ganache, so I just left it out, which is totally fine for ganache. But if this was covered in buttercream, you want to give yourself as much time with a cold cake as possible, so leave it into the refrigerator to the last necessary moment. And, okay. I think that's good. I have a couple of brush hairs. We don't like those. I don't know any brush that doesn't do that.
Me either.
Okay. I am going to keep in these pieces. I'm going to move them over here. I'm going to need these pieces in a minute. But I am ready to bring out my fondant. All right, make sure I'm ready to go. When you bring out your fondant from the freezer, you only have a few moments before it starts to defrost on you, so you got to move quickly, so you got to be ready to go. I think I'm ready to go. I hope I'm ready to go. That part was a little dry. Okay, I'm going to be right back.
Everybody having fun? I'm having fun.
Okay, so I have my fondant here. I'm working fast, guys. I want to get the straightest edge possible on the bottom. And I'm just going to pick it up. And wrap it around the cake. Oh, it looks like I wasn't tall enough. Uh-oh. Well, I'll show you how I deal with that. Or maybe I was. We'll see. Hold on.
I think you wrapped it with.
You're right, I did. Oh, thank you, Jennifer. I still have some play, so I'm going to fix that. There we go. Nope. I don't want to start over. Work with me, fondant. It tore here. I'm gonna. I'm going to pull this over. It's starting to defrost on me. I'm trying to work fast. I'm trying to get excuse me if I don't talk. I'm concentrating.
That's okay. I don't think any of us are breathing watching.
I'm not breathing either. You can see how much fun this is, guys. This is probably the scariest part of the whole thing. Whose idea was this to do a live tutorial on a bottle cake? Good lordy. Was it mine? Oh my goodness.
You cannot blame me for this one, Kara.
Whose idea was this? Well, you know, the good part about live is you can see how I deal with problems. You know, we can do perfect edited versions of a tutorial, but the truth is there's lots and lots of problems and how do you deal with that? Like, for instance, this problem. Trying to get a smooth finish to this contoured neck area. It is very nerve-wracking, this part right here. So I'm doing my best. To try and smooth. I want to get as much of this gathered into the back of this cake without creating holes or seams. What I'm going to do is trim some of this excess off. Okay, a little bit here, and pulling, I'm going to try to work backwards for you guys. So you can see, this is a hot mess back here, but I'm not going to panic. Oh no, I'm going to keep working, I'm going to pray to the fondant gods, and I'm going to keep smoothing away. Way too much. Try not to cut too much off because I still want to create the best seam possible in the back.
Now I know you said you could use buttercream as well, but I have to admit I'm watching this and I'm loving the fact that you use ganache. I don't know how buttercream would hold up under this.
Yeah, exactly. I have done it in buttercream. My last champagne bottle was buttercream, actually. And I don't know how I did it, but I did. Again, doing my best. I'm more concerned about the front being as smooth as possible. Because there's always a back to a cake, and by golly, this one has a back. I have way too much getting out of control. See, that's pretty ugly. But you guys, my front is actually looking pretty good. I gotta get some cornstarch on my hands because this was in the freezer and it gets awfully sticky. That's why you don't want to keep it in there too long. So I need to take a little break from that back seam. It's my heart palpitating. So I'm gonna take a breath and smooth out this front because really that's what I want mostly to be pretty. Okay? Because that's what's going to be sitting front and center. So I just want to make sure everything is pulled very pretty towards the back.
Would a mixture of fondant and modeling chocolate work for this application?
You know, I haven't used it, so I can't speak to that, but if you're like me, you'll just try it and see for yourself. But I would imagine that it might be a little bit more forgiving. I'm actually really quite happy right now because how does that look again from the front?
It looks fantastic.
So I'm going to keep doing my best to make sure there's no air pockets going on. And I'm going to get to that seam in the back in just a moment. Because what's more important, the front or the back? We want to make sure the front is pretty. More cornstarch because, and I'm going to use my fondant smoother. And remember that ledge, we can see it now, can't we?
Yep.
That's what we want, to give that, look at that, I love it. So I'm just making sure I can see it.
We don't have a question, but Shoba did want me to tell you that you work beautifully under pressure.
Oh, thank you, Shoba. Thanks for tuning in. Woo, that's a lot. I'm telling you guys, my heart is racing right now. This is definitely, but I don't know really any other great way to get this cake covered. So now what I'm doing, see if I can work backwards for you guys. Can you see that?
Yes.
Okay, so we've got some tears. This is definitely not pretty down here. But I'm going to see if I can get it pretty. And I probably should have made this a little bit wider. It's kind of barely needed. I like a little more of a overhang. Am I blocking? Let me know if my head or anything is blocking you, Jennifer.
No.
So I'm trying to get a good overlap so I can make hopefully a clean cut here. I'm just pushing. There we go. So I'm going to have to do some repairing right in this area. What I want to do is try to pinch these very jaggedy pieces of fondant together. kind of pinch them together, hopefully in a straight line. Okay. Now, what I'm going to, actually with this, I'm going to I'm going to try to create a nice seam. I'm going to try. I'm going to clean my blade off. How are we looking?
I can't believe we got to hear from where we were. You amaze me.
Right, like I kind of amaze myself. You guys, listen. Let's talk real. Cake is scary, but don't panic. You can make it to the end. I am nervous, but we're gonna keep going. Okay. I'm going to do my best to try to cut a nice seam. I'm going to stop right here because that is just really crazy right there. And how? Okay, filling it off. There's some bottom here. I'm going to cut away. Now I'm coming off, so I need some water. I'm taking a little bit of water because we're not sticking. I don't want air pockets. Okay. Got some pushing to do to get those to meet. And a little more trimming. And doing your best to get a clean seam, but again, we're mainly concerned about the front. So if this is not perfect, we are not going to be upset about it. And I'm doing my best to kind of massage that seam so it kind of disappears on us. All right, now we've got, whew, this is not cute. Okay, that looks good though down there, right?
It's amazing, yep.
Okay, so I'm going to have to move the cake a little bit towards me so I can see what I'm doing. I've got a mesh of stuff here. I'm going to show you how I, my hot water and spatula technique, too, on fixing this. I'm actually just going to use my scissors. I can see. Okay. Not cute, but we're okay. We're okay. We're not panicking. We're going to fix it. Going to fix it, taking away a little bit of excess. Now, the reason why this got really cruddy is because the bottle comes in. So I had a lot of extra fondant up here, and so it's just sort of created this, it's a mess, but that's why you have your scissors ready to go. So I kind of got a decent, push those seams together. Let's see if I can cut it down. All right, not too bad. I think I can cut more. I'm going to pinch a little bit more. Now, when I pinch, I am pinching and kind of pressing into the cake because I don't want to create any holes. And see if I can cut a little bit more. Of the excess. Okay, we're getting there, guys. We're getting there. I'm using my fingers to sort of mold the bottle down. I'm seeing a little bit too much extra. I'm going to get my knife in there and see if I can. There we go. And then I want to define that top. Remember, we had that little, there's a little lip. Okay. So all we have here is this mess. And I'm actually going to see if I can pull it down. I'm going to show you how we can fix that. Need a little water because it's pulling away right here. Okay. I'm actually going to use my that cutting board that I used earlier, and this really helps smooth down the seam too.
We have a question in regard to the LMF. Is it very moist in comparison to commercial fondants? Sugar Adventures has said that she is beyond amazed because she can't see any elephant skin.
She's beyond amazed because she sees what?
She can't see any elephant skin.
Oh, yeah. The other thing, too, is because I put it in the freezer. And so as it thawed, it kind of adds to the moisture a little bit and helps it kind of fix itself. But no, I don't. I'm looking. I don't really see much elephant skin going on. So I am going to try to see if we can get this. Time is running a little long. But I want to show you how I would fix this problem. Did I answer your question? Yes, I think LMF is, I guess, I don't know if moist is the right word, but I don't really recall many people or even myself having much elephant skin when using LMF. So, yeah. I don't know, Jen, I don't think you use it, so I guess you can't really help answer that question either.
I use it on dummies.
Oh, you do? Okay. So,
and it's beautiful.
I'm going to see where else I have issues. I am going to leave this for now, just because we're going long. But really, that's if you can see that, that's my only issue. And in a minute, I will see how much repair I need to do because there is another element that I am putting here. So it might hide that little part. So I'm going to move on. But how's that seam other than this section? How's that seam look?
Absolutely wonderful.
It looks pretty good from here too. So I'm using this to see if I can't. All right, I think we're going to move on. So, whew, I'm going to take a little breath. No, that wasn't scary at all. Down here is some extra fondant, so I'm just going to trim that away. A little sticky, too much water going on down there. There's a little bit of a hole here, but I think I can fix that. I just... using my fondant smoother. I'm going to use one of my little tools to kind of remember that little curved bottom. I want to make sure we still have that. I'm just pushing along and tucking that fondant in. Okay, I think we're good, and I don't see many air bubbles. So we're gonna move on. I'm gonna switch cameras. I don't like that look. That's the back. Okay, let me switch cameras. Okay, there is, on the bottle, there is a raised little, like, mountain sort of etched. But it's raised. If you feel it, you can feel it come off of the glass. So I am going to take this extra fondant that we have here, and I'm actually going to thin it out a little bit because I don't want it to be too bulky. And I'm going to use, sure it's not sticking. I'm going to use my ribbon strip and cut a strip. And this is how I would assume to make this if you don't have, and I can't imagine anyone would have a mold that fit that. I am going to make mountain-like zigzaggy cuts along one of the top edges. And varying it. Okay. And, ooh, I'm losing it. And now I'm going to take my fondant tool, and it has some ridges. Can we see that? There's some, like, ridges. So I'm just going to be random with it and make it look starting at the edge. But if they kind of go up, and I'm just making indents. And I'm really not being that specific. I guess you could if you really wanted to do that. But honestly, did your customer pay you that much money? Probably not. So we're just giving the sort of impression. And I am being so random right now. But I'm just making sure. And I probably have way too much. All right, that is good enough for me. Let's switch cameras and get back to the cake. Okay. So hopefully this will help cover up that little bit. I'm going to put a little bit of, and it sits right above this ridge line that we created. I think it's going to do really well, and I might even cheat. But I'm going to start this strip in the front. And I'm going to do my best to follow the ridge. Covering up a little bit. You like that? Uh-oh. That fell on me. Let's see if we have more. And push that down. Oh, I like it. I know it's white. I don't think you guys can see. But I like the way it's looking. And it covered up that really bad little hole. And look at that! We fixed it! That's the back of the cake. And here's the front. Can we see that? Let me look. You guys see that? So that gives us that raised little area. I'm liking it. Okay, you guys, believe it or not, we are almost done. So I'm going to quickly clean up a little bit and move on because I want to airbrush this cake. And we'll see if I can do another technique with the make it look like glass, so we have to make sure the airbrush dries. What's our time look like? Oh, okay, we're not too bad. We're not too bad. Any questions?
Not personally.
I'm cleaning up. I'm gonna move my cake over for a second. Get it here. Quickly cleaning up. Okay, so my friend Jennifer has a tutorial on an airbrush booth, and I'm going to break mine out, and she shows you how to put it together, or you can just buy the kit from her. This helps the airbrush from not covering my house. So here's that. Get my fan. In there. Plug myself in. Put some paper down. My turntable. And let's just hope this sucker fits. You know what? I don't think we're going to do... Well, let me think. I need a bigger one, Jen.
You can always make the legs taller.
That's true. Okay. How's that? Let me see. Okay, there we go. Okay. So, this bottle is pretty much brown. But there's some dark, like when you, because there's liquid in there, depending on where the light is hitting it, there's going to be lighter shades, and then like right here, it's darker. So I'm just going to set my bottle down and then just look at the bottle while I airbrush. And I'm using chocolate brown Air Mist airbrush color. Put some gloves on here. Jen, can you hear me okay?
I can.
All right. Got my airbrush. I'm not fancy dancy airbrush. I got the Duff's one that I got from Michael's with a 50% coupon. So that's going to have to do for us. I'm going to fill up my... Now, I am not the best airbrusher. There are some really great airbrush people, and I'm not one of them. But I think I can do enough to get the job done. So, loading up my airbrush color. And let's cross our fingers. I'm turning on my machine. I'm going to go low because I don't like it coming out too fast on me. I'm going to start in the back. It's a little cruddy back there, but it's the back. And it's pretty dark around that area, so I'm just going to start, make sure I'm not blocking too much. Jen, let me know if I'm in the way. I block from view. Now, so you go to get sort of a lighter look, you just pull it back a little bit. But I really want to make sure there's no white showing, so I got to get in there. Another great thing about the airbrush versus covering the cake in pre-colored fondant, it is already gives you a really shine and a really glassy look for a bottle. So, I'm not really being very specific because, remember, the bottle has very different shades of brown, light, dark. So, really, the kind of random you go, it actually turns out kind of perfect. And some areas are lighter, some areas are darker. More airbrush. It's starting to come alive, you guys. Jen, are you still there?
I am.
Okay. Now, the cake board, I don't think I'm going to have time to show you that today. You can cover it in fondant. I'm not going to be so worried about getting airbrush on it, because I was going to cover it anyway. But if you were, so it's probably best that you cover it last, But if you've already covered it, then you just probably need to put some paper around it so it doesn't get airbrushed on it. You know what I forgot to do, Jen? I forgot to turn on the machine.
I was wondering if you had the fan on.
It's on now. Okay, so just going around. Remember, I'm not being concerned about even coverage because it's supposed to look light in some areas and dark in others. My husband snuck in on us trying to take pictures. I'm loving the way it's turning out.
I think it looks fantastic.
So the bottom is really dark on the bottle, so I'm just going to go darker around the bottom of the cake. By my front. I think it looks pretty good right there.
That's awesome.
A little bit more around some edges. I like it. I like it a lot. Fine. Okay. Move it on. I want to get the fan on this. Look how pretty, Jen!
It's fantastic.
That's looking pretty darn good. I'm going to put the fan on this. And I'm going to turn it to the front because I want it to dry. But you see, I didn't, it naturally, because I was very uneven with my airbrushing, that it naturally gives it the shading that the bottle has. So it's working out pretty good. So we're going to move on. To the images. I'm going to switch cameras. Is that fan too loud, Jen? Should I turn it off, or what should we
do? No, I can hear you perfectly.
Okay. Okay. I'm going to switch cameras. me again. Okay, so these images are printed out on wafer paper. So what I did was I found, I just Googled Coors Light bottle labels, and I found one that was a higher resolution, and I copied it, and I put it into my Word file. And again, measuring the actual bottle label, I just doubled it. So when I went to size it in my Word document, I sized it to the correct size for the label for our cake. Same with, I really couldn't find the exact label on the neck, so I just kind of found something that would be sufficient enough. So we're just going to go with that. And then I kind of cut it inward a little bit because it's going to fit around the neck part of the cake. So wafer paper actually, in my opinion, does better if it's got a white fondant backing, because it's a little see-through. So if we put something white, it makes the colors of the print really pop. So that's what we're going to do. I'm going to get some white fondant, and I'm going to make it really thin, because we don't want it to be bulky. We want it to look like an actual paper label, but we don't want it to be too bulky. So I'm going to show you this. I got some cornstarch. And I roll it out. This fondant was some of the leftover fondant from our trying to cover our cake. So it's not the whitest, but it doesn't need to be perfectly white because it's getting covered. So I try to use I'm really rolling it really thin. I mean, that is super thin, guys. Paper thin. Let me see if I have enough. A little bit, maybe this way. A little bit more. Okay, that's good. Let's see if I can get this other piece in there. Almost. A little bit. Okay, we're good. So now what I'm going to do is I have piping gel. And I'm going to liberally brush piping gel along the back of the image. Both images. Now, sometimes these images will get bubbles in them, and I'm still working that out for myself, but I was told maybe not to put piping gel along the entire back of the image, but maybe at certain points. So I'll have to try that another day, but I'm just going to do for you now what I normally do, and I'm just brushing very liberally. Okay, so adhering it on to, now I want to push as many air bubbles out, sort of like pick up and smooth the paper down. Now, you could hand paint this label, but again, I ask you, did your customer pay you enough money for that time? Probably not. So use your edible images. And I actually think they look better, because it actually looks more like the real thing. So, okay, so now I'm going to take my X-Acto knife and I'm going to cut through the fondant right around both labels. Okay, I'm going directly. I don't want to see any fondant. I just want to see the picture. Doing my best. Trying to go a little faster for you guys. We're almost done, actually. I'm telling you, the hardest part of this cake is the carving of it and getting that fondant on. Everything else is pretty easy after that. Okay, so now I have my images. So I'm going to switch cameras and go back to the cake and apply it to the cake. One second. Okay, so I'm going to brush the back can you see this? Actually, before I do that, I just want to see what that's going to look like. Oh, that's going to look pretty. Okay, I'm going to take a little bit of water.
We have a question, Kara.
Yes?
Should I use darker fondant if the edible image is darker, for example, black, or would you still put it on a white backing?
Sorry, I could not hear you. Let me go and read it. Should I use darker fondant if the edible image is darker, for example, black? No, I don't think so. White. I've only used white, and I've had darker, always white. You could try it. I honestly don't think that the image is really going to pop out if you use darker fondant. Okay. So let me find my front. I'm really liking this cake. Oh, my God. I love it when that happens. Okay, so here's my front. Line it up in the middle first. And wrap it around. Oh, I kind of pulled. Let me clean my hands. Okay, right here, I kind of pulled a little bit of that fondant out. So I'm just going to trim it down. It's looking like a bottle. Okay, let me get my next one. And wetting the back. Okay. Now it's going to sit in between these two little ridges here. I gotta get centered. Okay, I'm gonna dry my hands. It's a little wet. And press it. Cool. Do you guys see that? Hello. I love it when a cake comes together. Looky, looky. That the last thing that we're gonna do is the top. So I got a couple of cutters, so I just want to see, it's going to come over to kind of meet up with this ridge. I probably could have done a little bit better job with that ridge molding. So I think that one is perfect. I'm going to grab some fondant. And get it. Again, I'm going to paint this silver, so I'm not so concerned that it's perfectly white. So all of those stained pieces of fondant, don't throw them away. I'm just making sure there's no, and I can't find. So I'm going to make a thick ball here and see if you can see that. I'm going to pat it down so that it'll fit. And I think I want it to be about, you know, what is that? Quarter, maybe more than a quarter of an inch thick. A little cornstarch on this table. And we cut a piece out here and take, we have these little ridges around our bottle. So I'm going to take a fondant tool, any tool really, and I'm going to make impressions into the fondant to make it look like a bottle cap. Okay, that looks good. Let's try it. Looking good, guys. So, a little water on the top. Not having too much water. And loosen it over. Top of the cake. Now, I have some silver luster dust. I've used this before, so this is just what got dried and left over. So I keep them in these cups. And I have Everclear 190 proof. Is that considered vodka? Well, Everclear. You can get it. I actually got this online because you can't buy it in California. And I'm going to put a little bit in my cup. And mix it to a paste. And we'll paint the top. I'll try to go faster. I'm just going to do the fret for now, so we can move on to the last step. Now you could get your paintbrush and make that top part if you want. I probably would if this was for a real customer, but I'm not going to do that today. And if you're not good at freehanding, you could always do you could sort of copy this out on paper, place it on top, use a little stick pin to mark the image, and then go back and paint with a black paintbrush. So that's how you would do that. Okay, is that all covered? How's that looking, Jen?
Looks fantastic, hon.
Okay, let me see if my paint is dry. Jen, it's dry. I think we should go for it. So, there's that sort of just came out the cooler, ice cooler look of a real refreshing beer look, and the bottle looks wet. So, how are you going to get that wet look? Is you're going to mix the big old jug of corn syrup. Equal parts corn syrup. Grab a brush. To equal parts vodka, or do what I use, Everclear. And I probably cannot really see that. I'm going to mix it together thoroughly. Mix, mix, mix. And how you can do this is we're going to brush the cake with this. And it's going to dry. I'm going to start, always start in the back, just in case you mess up a little bit. Yes. So, I am not going to do the whole cake, because we don't need to sit here for an hour. Well, it won't take me an hour, but you know. To do that, but I want to show you, and maybe it'll pick up on the camera, a nice, it's going to leave, it's going to leave a nice, shine, sort of glassy finish to the cake. And make sure your airbrush paint is dry before you do that, or you might start running into problems of your, is that showing up on camera?
It is.
It's so nice. The other thing, and I don't have a dropper, if you got like an eye dropper, or like a medicine dropper, and I don't have one right now. You could make little droplets sort of randomly over your cake, and it kind of, it'll dry with these sort of, and I, you probably can't even see that on camera, but it'll look like it's condensating off of the bottle. And it will dry like that. So, again, that was an equal parts mixture of corn syrup and vodka or Everclear. And you're just going to brush your entire cake like that, and it gives this really great glossy finish to your cake. So it makes it look like a bottle. Ooh, it's so pretty. I love it when the cakes come together. That is it, you guys. I'm not going to do this whole thing for you because you just don't need to sit here for the whole thing. But what I would do next, I'm finished. I'll put fondant on my board, white, or actually, this is a cake board that has that, it's already coated or with that material. What is that material? Like a wax material?
Mm-hmm. It's like a parchment.
Yeah. You can just wipe that off. Can you see that? I'm wiping it off. You can wipe off your board too, or cover your board before you do that spray paint. This is a little bit messy.
Someone messaged and said that it is brilliant.
Who said that?
Shoba.
Shoba! I would probably just clean this board and leave it like that because honestly, I don't like wasting fondant on a board if you don't have to. This board is fine enough. If you want to dress up your board, you can. You can put fondant over it. But I really like how the edge looks like a bottle. So I'll probably just spend some time cleaning up my board. But again, you could already prep your board, but make sure you put some sort of covering over it when you go to airbrush. Or clean it off like I'm doing, or go ahead and put some fondant over that and just finish your board with a nice ribbon. And look at that. Now that's a nice groom's cake. So let's do a side-by-side, shall we? How awesome is that? It's gorgeous. So that's it, you guys. I hope I answered or was thorough enough with the demo tutorial today. Let me go sit back down and talk to you.
Okay. I did it live. That was scary, by the way. That covering that fondant with, woo. I'm just that kind of crazy girl, but I'm glad you guys got to see how to sort of solve problems or work with a problem. Like, we covered that hole up by adding that band around with the mountain look. Of course, if I wasn't doing this live, I'd probably spend a lot more time and a lot more patience of time to really make it perfect. So, but I hope that was good. Is there, Ashley said it looks awesome. Thanks, Ashley.
And there's a question on how long the corn syrup mixture takes to dry.
You know, I don't know. Probably, let me test it. Let me see. It's going to probably take about an hour at least to make sure it's really dry. What do you think, Jen? Have you used that?
I would say the same. And I don't think it ever dries like...
Yeah, dry dries.
Yeah.
Dry. When you put it in the refrigerator, it will dry because it's cold. But then as you take it out of the refrigerator, it does condensate a little bit, and so it'll get sticky again. But like all cakes, don't touch it. Don't touch the cake. Let it come to room temperature and let it dry on its own, and it will be fine. Just don't nobody touch the cake. It's really pretty, guys. Look at that. Keep looking at it. Ooh, look at that. That's so pretty. Don't mind my messy kitchen in the back. okay, guys, that's it, and we did good. We went at just a little bit over 2 hours. That was... Let's say hello to Jen again. Jen, thank you so much. You're so pretty, and you're such a awesome person for sitting with me for 2 hours on something you probably already know how to do way better than I do. I just love that.
Sweetheart. I love you too.
Okay, guys, that's it. If you have any questions, just under the YouTube page, you can leave a question, and I'll be happy to answer it. Hopefully, I'll have the answer for you. Remember, keep the link to this viewing, and you can watch it over and over and over again. And please, if you make a bottle cake based off of my tutorial, please share it on my page. Let me know. I want to see it. Again, I hope that I've helped, and I hope to see more bottle cakes from you guys in the future. Say goodbye, Jen.
Goodbye.
Bye, guys. See you next time.